Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our webinar on Is Solar Power Right for Your Business? Thank you for joining us. My name is Kerri-Anne McLeod, and I'm the Events Coordinator from the New South Wales Business Chamber. I will be your moderator for today. I'm joined by Oliver Hartley, Managing Director from EFO. Good afternoon, Oliver.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, Kerri-Anne.
If you have any questions today, please submit these via the chat box on the bottom left-hand corner of your screen, and we will endeavour to answer as many as possible throughout the presentation. I will now hand you over to Oliver.
Thank you very much, Kerri-Anne. So I actually would like to start this webinar with our first polling question, and that is really, is electricity a rising and significant part of your business expenses? So if you don't mind that we start this engagement, just press your buttons, whether yes or no, and then we'll give you a couple of minutes and see how that goes. So is that a real a rising and significant part of your business? So we've got about 27 answers now. I think that's sort of stabilizing at this stage. So about 80% of you in the webinar at the moment say yes, it is significant, and it is a rising factor. So I think on the back of that is the question whether solar is something that can actually help to tackle this issue and this problem, and how much solar can save each individual business. So the way we want to address this question is basically in this type of summary. To get you interested, first of all, in this webinar, I want to start with this summary here. This is a system, a 100 kilowatt solar system, and the numbers for this one is it would take about 400 panels, so about 1,000 square meters on your business roof. It would generate, I'm pointing with the laser pointer here, about 143,000 kilowatt hours per annum. And for a typical business, maybe a small manufacturing business or an engineering business or something like that, it would offset between 20 to 30% of its power use. The saving that would be generated from this 100 kilowatt solar system are summarized down here. So typically in the first year, maybe $25,000, maybe $30,000 is sort of the savings for in the first year. But obviously the solar system is going to generate electricity from the sun over decades. So over 10 years, the solar system would generate savings over $300,000. And over the entire life of the solar system, it would generate over $1 million in terms of savings. Now, what is interesting is obviously solar power is in an infrastructure type of asset. So you have one upfront investment, and then you basically lock in the benefits. The way this can be looked at is in the following manner, with the rate of solar power. So the system will generate electricity over 25 years or 30 years. Normally it's calculated over 25 years, and you have one initial upfront investment. For this particular example, you would actually lock in an equivalent electricity rate of 4 cents per kilowatt hour. So very, very low compared to what you currently pay. Obviously, there are environmental benefits. We always try to express that in something that is more tangible. So we say cars off the road. So here in New South Wales, the way the electricity is generated, and we can calculate it into cars off the road because of the CO2 reduction, it's about 47 cars off the road. That 100 kilowatt solar system would require an investment of around $140,000-$150,000. Obviously, that varies. It varies from building to building, from where your business is. But it's just to give you a ballpark figure for this example, it's around $145,000. The return for this 100 kilowatt system is around 21% an IRR, so internal rate of return or return on investment. For very good cases, and I'll show you some later on, this can actually go up to 25 or 30% or even above. Other systems might only have a return of maybe 15 to 20%. Last but not least, a lot of people, a lot of businesses look at payback period. This example would just be between 4 to 5 years in terms of payback period. Worst cases can be maybe 7 or 8 years. Obviously, very bad case, it can be much longer. But this is sort of a typical figure here, 4 to 5 years. So that's sort of the summary. This is what the benefits are that can be generated by solar power. So let's dive into the details and how I want to address this question. Is solar power right for my business? So we've got 6 bullet points here. So the first one is really I want to explain on one slide very briefly where solar power stands today. Then solar power for business, what does that actually mean and how does it work? Then I will spend a bit more time on extracting this solar business case. So solar business case really means, is it an economically viable investment to go into solar power for your business? So that's one of the key factors we looked at. And then are certain options on how can I finance this? Obviously, you can put your own money into that solar system right away, but there are third-party finance or power purchase agreement, and we'll talk about that in a bit. And then there's something at the last point, which is quite current at the moment, is really the uncertainty about renewable energy policy. You might have picked that up in the news or on television, that the renewable energy target was reviewed by a specially set up review panel, and they came out with their recommendation, and I will elaborate on that a little bit at the end of the presentation. I understand you can put questions forward at any time, so when questions pop up, I will address them as we go. Okay, let's jump in then. So where do we stand today here in Australia with regard to solar power? Australia is actually pretty good with regard to solar power. There have been 1.3 million solar systems installed in Australia. That is a big, big number. And cumulative power installed from solar is actually 3.2 gigawatts. So that is, for a while, Australia was actually amongst the top 10 on that scale in the world. What is very unique for Australia is that the average system size is quite small, with 4.5 kilowatts. So 4.5 kilowatts is actually a typical household system. So this gives you an indication that the 1.3 million solar systems are predominantly installed on residential rooftops. And this is still the main share of the solar market. So 80-90% of the market is still residential. This was in the past driven by feed-in tariffs and other government incentives. Most of these incentives have gone away. So now it's really to look at the underlying economic value of solar. And this is actually what excites us at EFO. So EFO is a company that's specialized in developing commercial solar systems. That's all we do. And we get excited by the fact that solar produces electricity during the day, and that's the time when businesses use electricity. So that's when people are at work, or whether then they are at universities or schools or other institutions, and that's when they use electricity, and that's when solar generates electricity. So the match between solar generation capacity and the business needs in terms of electricity matches quite well in businesses, and that's really where we believe there's going to be a very good growth path in solar over the next coming years, almost independent of what the government does. So that's where we stand with solar today in Australia. Let's move on then how solar works. Okay, this is a pretty busy slide, but I'll walk you through it. So first of all, just solar 101. You do need sunlight, so you don't want heat, you really want the sunlight shines onto the solar panels. Then the solar panels generate electrons, which is our little symbol here, the E minus, which is the symbol for electrons. They go into an inverter that converts the DC current, the direct current, into AC, and then either that electricity is used behind the meter in your appliances and your load, or it basically is fed into the grid. If the solar doesn't produce electricity, you get your electricity from the grid. So we're not talking about off-grid or isolated systems. It's really you stay connected to the grid. So what's the benefit of solar? This you see on the right-hand side. So we have some here a day, 24 hours. for a two-shift business. So I hope you can see that here. The business sort of starts in the morning at around 5, 6 o'clock. The electricity consumption goes up throughout the day. It basically fluctuates, and then late in the evening, the business shuts down and it goes into an overnight mode. So this is the old electricity consumption that the business has. Now, that business with solar. This is the generation profile of a solar system. Obviously, the solar system produces the largest amount of electricity when at midday, when the sun is the highest and we have the most amount of sunshine. This means that now we actually don't need to purchase that much electricity from the grid anymore, which you see here with is this blue line. So the new consumption from the grid is this blue line down here. So the solar system has generated this amount of value, which is this yellow area. This is what we call the solar value, and that needs to be maximized and needs to match with your consumption profile. So that's the key underlying benefit of solar power. So it's offsetting electricity consumption during the day from the grid, and that's where you save with solar power. Now when we move on, just try to move on here. Okay, now would it work for your business? There are normally three key factors which we look at. One is the roof space. So with regard to the roof space, so you do need some roof space, or the premise which you rent needs to have some roof space. So recently we were asked by an insurance company, Munich Re, here in the Sydney CBD. They have a nice big office building and they have their corporate targets in terms of sustainability, and they wanted a solar system on their roof. And they were really keen. The only problem is that from 10 o'clock onwards, this building is completely shaded by surrounding high rises here in the CBD. So I basically had to go back to them and say, guys, it really, solar system is not the way you should reduce your electricity consumption. You need to do other things. Solar just doesn't cut it for you. So we do need roof space, and we need to have that roof space not shaded by trees or other buildings, and it should be mainly free from any vents and other things. So a nice open roof is just perfect for solar. The second big area we want to always look at is the power usage. So only the power you use is really relevant. There are storage options out there, battery storage and other things to do peak shavings. Look at the economic value and maximize the economic value. It's very, very important that the solar offsets your consumption behind the meter. So if you have the good roof space, the next thing is to look at the power usage and whether you use it during the day. So a typical business Monday to Friday, maybe from 8 to 5 with some decent consumption is perfect for solar. Let's assume the other extreme, you run a restaurant and you're only open in the evenings, then solar is probably not such a good value proposition. There are exceptions, so we are currently developing a solar system for a dairy farm up in Queensland, for example. They have a very big peaky consumption, so they milk in the morning, midday and late afternoon, and in between they have hardly any consumption. What we propose to that client is indeed a battery system, because during the times when they don't use any electricity, we can charge up the batteries, and then the batteries can basically power the milking sessions. So power usage is a very important factor, and we spend a lot of time analyzing that. The third area is your timeline. And there are two factors. One is really, are you going to be in business for the next sort of 3 to 7 years? Or is your business going to go through dramatic changes? Let me give you an example on the latter one. Let's assume you're a manufacturer at this stage, and but you plan to change your whole structure, business model, from manufacturing to a service industry. Obviously, your consumption, your electricity consumption, will change dramatically. In that case, we would say, okay, why don't you go through that transition first? and we look at your new consumption after you've made the transition, and we can then evaluate the benefit of solar and the benefits the solar would bring to your business. So this is really the three key factors. We would have an initial conversation with you whether solar makes sense for your business. All right, before we now carry on, I want to have a bit of engagement again. Let's look at this question here. So if you don't mind, could you just press the button now whether you've gone through this, yes or no? And why we ask this is really that sometimes solar and energy efficiencies are seen as opposing programs, and that's definitely not the case. They should go hand in hand. So in many cases, when we talk to clients, they have already gone through an energy efficiency program, or they have at least internally not an official energy efficiency program, but they are energy aware, have a certain energy awareness in their business, and at that level, solar then makes sense. If you waste electricity left, right, and center, it's really you should try to get this energy efficiency awareness into your company first, and then talk about solar. So it's not an either or; it's really an and, and both should be tackled. As I said, it doesn't need to be a formal energy efficiency program. I think most businesses know themselves whether they waste electricity or not. If they waste electricity, have a look at that waste and try to reduce it, and then we can go forward. So the result is about 55% haven't had an official an energy efficiency program, but 46% actually have done that. So that's pretty good. And as I said, it needs to go hand in hand, both of them. So thanks for your participation in this one. Let's now carry on. The economic value. So we have said yes to all three questions, right? So you have a roof, which is usable for solar. Your energy consumption is during the day. And then the third one is your timeline is at least sort of around 5 years, so you can benefit from the solar system. Now, the first step in creating the solar business case, the solar business case is basically a study and analysis that puts forward the economic value of the solar business in your particular case. So it really varies a lot from business to business. The starting point is always the electricity bill. And some electricity bills look very simple. It's really maybe just cents per kilowatt hour if you are a small office or have a very low consumption. But in most cases, when we deal with businesses, they're actually quite complex. So up here, you see an electricity bill. Obviously, you can't read it, but that's not the point of it. It's really just to show you there's a long list of individual items. This is energy charges and cents per kilowatt hours. There are day charges. There are meter charges. There are demand charges. There are environmental charges, and so on and so forth. So typically, there might be 12 different types of charges that make up your electricity bill. So what do we do with this? We basically start, first of all, to dissect this electricity bill. So the first thing is what we do is to look what your consumption is in the different categories of rates. So you typically have a peak rate, a shoulder rate, and an off-peak rate. The electricity consumed in these different periods varies significantly. So obviously the off-peak rate is the lowest, and the peak rate is the highest. So for this particular business, which we used as an example, about 19%, let me get the pointer, about 19% is actually consumed during peak. That is the most costly electricity you can consume. About 50% is consumed during shoulder, and about 30% is consumed during off-peak. So this might be nighttime or weekends. But again, this varies a lot from area to area, from business to business, and from your retailer to your retailer. So that's the first thing we need to go through. So second thing is then, all right, we have designed a solar system, or draft an initial solar system for your building. Then your solar system will produce electricity throughout the day when the sun shines. It will produce Monday to Friday, but it obviously will also produce on the weekends. So what we do is then to calculate at what period the solar system generates electricity. So in this particular case, the solar system would have produced about 15% of the power that the solar system produced would have been produced during peak hours, so the most valuable electricity. About 66% would have been produced during shoulder periods, so that's the second valuable electricity, and then only 2% would have been produced during off-peak. You see a fourth category here, which is actually with 17%. So this is PV fed into the grid. So PV stands for photovoltaic or solar electricity. So 17% of the solar electricity generated by the system is fed into the grid. In most cases, in the vast majority of cases, that electricity is worthless at this stage. When you come to renegotiate your electricity bill, you can go to your retailer and say, you know, I'm exporting 25,000 kilowatt hours per annum of electricity into the grid. What can you give me for that? And you might get 6 or 8 cents per kilowatt hour for that electricity that's fed to the grid. So again, this is a very important one, because here on this chart you offset the most valuable electricity. You have the off-peak, the shoulder rate, which you substitute, which might then be, this is maybe 25 cents per kilowatt hour, this might be 20 cents per kilowatt hours in terms of value. You have off-peak, which is maybe 10 cents, and this is zero. So this puts together the overall value of your solar power, which you substitute. And then last but not least, we basically can tell you how much electricity would be offset by your solar system. In this case, it would be 37% in the future would come from your solar system. You would still purchase the residual amount from the grid. Now, a question has just come through. So the question says, do you need a roof? Can it be a standalone structure? Absolutely, it can be a standalone structure. So if the roof, for example, on a lot of farms, maybe the buildings are pretty old or the roof needs replacing in the near future, but there's a lot of land area around. You can also put in a ground mount solar system and feed the electricity into your system from a ground mount system, so there's no dramas. It's really, at the end of the day, it's a cost analysis. Normally a roof mount solar system is slightly cheaper than a ground mount system, but that depends completely and it varies from case to case. So ground mount is absolutely fine, and for ground mounts the same logic applies, which I go through here at this point in time. Okay, so we have analyzed our electricity bill. We now go to the next section that needs to be analyzed, the system design. So system design is really something that is probably very different for commercial solar system to the residential solar system. So in the past, because I told you in the past, the vast majority of the market was a residential system. So usually in the morning, there was the electrician with maybe 6 or 8 solar panels in the back of the ute. He rocked up to you to your home in the morning, climbed up onto the roof with a ladder, put up the solar system in, let's say, 2 or 3 hours, and then drove off again. There was no real design or electrical drawings behind that. It was very simple, very straightforward. With commercial system, this is quite different, particularly with larger ones. In New South Wales, when you go over 10 kilowatts, you need, for example, approval or a compliant development certificate from the council. So that's something that your solar developer needs to go through. In terms of the design, down here, it's a bit hard to see, but this is the roof plan of a big aged care facility that is getting built, and we develop a 100 kilowatt solar system for them. So there's quite a lot of detailed design that needs to go on, because we need to build around the venting system and the air conditioning system on the roof and still make sure that nothing gets shaded. And obviously then a very detailed electrical design needs to follow to make sure that this is all in place, that we know where the inverters go, where the cable runs are, how we connect it to the main switchboard, that it integrates into the overall system quite incorporate or in, can be integrated well without any issues. Particularly with the large systems, that's quite a challenge sometimes, so that needs to be done properly. And that's, I think, the big difference between the residential and the commercial businesses, that if you are not really focused on commercial solar, the business might struggle with getting these designs right. Let's move on. So we have done the electricity bill analysis. We have done the system design. Now the next thing that needs to be done is the performance forecast. So we have the solar system now designed onto the roof, but how much do we actually get out of it? How much electricity is actually generated? In some cases, it's pretty straightforward. If we have a roof without any shading, without any trees or anything around it, it's quite a simple analysis. If we, however, like in this example here, we have something like these billboards on the roof, it's quite a sophisticated analysis that needs to follow. So what we did here is we basically analyzed the system and we modeled these billboards. And we have roof north in this direction. So we simulated very detailed when what shading happens and how much we actually get out of the system. Because what is obvious that throughout the year, the solar system will generate more electricity in January. So you have months by months here for a solar system and the specific output. So the overall bar is the overall electricity that's sort of generated, but there are some losses in here and capture losses. And then we have this variation in terms of output month by month. So in the winter months, we generate less. In the summer months, we generate more. This depends on many, many factors, but it all needs to be analyzed to actually predict the output of the solar system and the economic value of the solar system correctly. Now we've done all this work, we can now move on and go to the actual important factor, which is the financial modeling. So the financial modeling then puts all the other aspects together. And the system design, the electricity bill, so the solar value of the solar value of your system, the performance, the output, it all goes into a comprehensive financial model, and you get your typical KPIs, financial KPIs. So the key performance indicators like return on investment, payback period. With larger corporations, they look at net present value. They look at discounted cash flow. So everything, all these KPIs, these financial KPIs, comes out of the financial model, and then the client is enabled to make an educated decision whether he wants to go with solar or whether not. So the economic benefits of solar power comes out of this financial model. And this then, whether the client then goes ahead or not, varies from business to business. So here on the right-hand side, you see a solar system that we installed on DB Schenker. DB Schenker is a big logistics company, a worldwide logistics company. So this is on a system on their new cold storage facility up in Brisbane. They had certain internal hurdle rates in terms of return investment and how much electricity they want to offset. So they used this as their pilot facility, and now they have to they have decided to go on and basically have a solar system also on their facility here in Sydney in Alexandria, and then hopefully if they're happy with that, they go on to the next solar system. So it's quite a bit of work that needs to go into the solar business case, but the outcome then tells you exactly what you can expect from your solar system. Now, one thing is the analysis that goes into it. Now, the second thing is obviously the analysis only one part of it. If the solar system is then not well installed and not well maintained, you obviously don't get what you were hoping for. So the key thing is really that a commercial solar system is something that is a bit more sophisticated than the standard residential system. It is not just a product that you can go out and purchase. It needs to be a well-engineered, designed and installed product and system that really only if you achieve that, you get what you wanted out of your returns and the predicted financial benefits from the solar system. So at the moment, we have a situation in the market. There are loads, hundreds and hundreds of solar companies, and a lot of these solar companies press into the commercial market, and obviously everybody says they can do it. So I can only encourage you that if you decide to go with solar and you want to use solar to offset your electricity costs, do your due diligence. Make sure that the company you choose actually has the capacity and the skills to deliver the commercial solar, so you get the returns you expect. I want to just point out to two things that we see sometimes out there in the market at this stage, because the commercial market is still relatively young. We do have a couple of companies that maybe overstretch themselves in terms of capabilities. So one thing which we see quite common is that the companies overstate the benefits of solar. So for example, they take the overall electricity bill and then just divide it by the kilowatt hours you use, and it gives you the value of solar. Obviously, I showed you earlier, this is not correct, because you do have charges that are not offset by solar, so day charges or a demand charges to a certain degree. So it really is important that the company does that analysis properly. The other aspect we see quite often is that then companies go in and predict very aggressive energy price rises. So for example, in this model which we were given to evaluate, that particular solar company assumed a 10% electricity price rise over the next 5 years. I mean, I think that's pretty unrealistic. When you go out and look at different reports, when you go out and get different feedbacks from where the prices will go, a typical value is around 5% to 7.5% over the next 10 to 15 years in terms of electricity price rises. At the moment, the electricity prices are relatively stable, but let's say in 2 to 3 years, they will catch up again and the rise is going to happen. So what we tend to do is then we go in with a 5% electricity price rise, but we provide the client with a variance analysis. So we assume a 2.5% and a 7.5% rise, and obviously that will impact the economic value and benefits of the solar system. So that's one thing. You know, does the company give you a fair assessment of the benefits of solar? And then obviously on the right-hand side, you see here a solar system that's just badly designed. I mean, these solar modules were put on the south side of this pretty steep sloping roof here. I mean, these panels hardly see the sun ever, and obviously you can imagine you will hardly get any electricity out of these solar panels. So if the system is badly designed, you're just not gonna get what you expected. So just watch out there, get yourself, do your due diligence, and partner with a good company that is experienced in commercial solar, and then you get with high reliability returns on your investment that you expect. All right, let's carry on now. So we have a solar system. It makes sense for you. You have partnered with or have chosen a commercial solar company that can deliver on their promises. Now the next question is, well, how do I finance it? What are my options? There are basically, I think, sort of three categories which I want to walk you through. The one category is the one that's pretty straightforward. Your business has the money and they would like to directly invest in the solar system. Whether you're the tenant or whether you're the building owner, it doesn't really matter, as long as you have the approval from the building owner that you can put the solar system on the roof, you can go ahead with it. So when you say you want to invest directly, the driving factor is really return on investment and the payback period. So you want to secure an attractive return on investment, you want the system ownership, you want to benefit from the depreciation, and it's a pretty simple transaction. The drawback is obviously that you have to have the upfront capital expenditure available, the CapEx, and then you are also responsible for operation maintenance. In a lot of cases, our clients then basically decide to sign up with an operation maintenance agreement for the first 2 to 3 years, where we monitor the solar system in 5 minute increments, where we send monthly reports to the client and the client understands how the solar system works. Maybe then in 3 years he decides or they decide to do the operation maintenance themselves through their facility management department. But that's then an open discussion. So that's the one that's pretty straightforward and the easiest. Now, there are obviously other options. The second option, which is currently very, very common, is actually a third-party finance. So that could be an operating lease. It could be a chattel mortgage. And there are plenty of third-party financiers available. So we are, for example, a preferred supplier to Macquarie Bank, but there are other banks and lenders out there that provide finance there. It could be an operating lease, as I said, or a chattel mortgage. What are the benefits? Obviously, the key benefit is there's no initial capital investment required, and you basically have, you know exactly how much you spend per month, and it's quite easy and straightforward. The drawback is that the lease payments is basically because it's like an equipment finance, you just have to pay whether the system performs or not. So there it's very important again to get a good solar developer so the system actually performs well, that you have an operation maintenance contract in place to ensure that the system performs well. And once you have all that in place, there's very little risk around your solar system and you have the benefits of a third-party finance that you don't have to put up the capital up front. Now, the third one, that is just really happening and we see more and more coming, but it's still relatively slow in the take-up. The power purchase agreement. So this means that you do not own the solar system. The developer or a third-party asset management company owns the solar system, and you just buy the electricity generated by the solar system. Now, the benefits are you have no ownership in that. You have no nothing to do with the maintenance. There's no additional operation maintenance costs. You have no risk in terms of performance. The risk is all with the owner of the solar system. And you only buy the kilowatt hours you use. Now, the drawback is, obviously, you have no measurable really return on investment because you have a third-party investor. They require their returns on investment, and basically through your PPA you need to pay for that. It can be more complex because in some cases it what depends with the electricity that gets fed into the grid. It's usually, you know, it is a more complex contractual arrangement sometimes, and you need to look into the details there. Now, when you only purchase the electricity, you don't get free electricity. In the other two cases where you directly invest or when you finance it and you have a lease arrangement, let's say over 5 years, after 5 years you own the solar system and then you get the free electricity from the solar system. And the solar system will generate electricity if it's well designed for decades. 25 years is guaranteed on the modules, but it easily will generate for 30 years. So if you're locked into a power purchase agreement, obviously you do not benefit from that free electricity. And very often you see very long-term contracts, so maybe 10 years or even 15 years of power purchase agreement. And what we find that companies are sometimes hesitant to get themselves locked into these contracts. So these are three very different models, and it's really up to you to say what fits to your business. I've just had a question come through. Now, let's assume, and that's actually quite a common question, let's assume you have a direct investment or a finance. You have your system paid off after 5 years, and then let's say in year 6 or 7, you decide to move on into a different premises. Now, the question is, what are typical costs of moving a solar system in the event we move premises, say as a percentage of initial system costs? This is a very, very good question. Unfortunately, at this stage, there is not a real ballpark figure I can give you. I can basically tell you the following. The modules can be removed from the roof, and they are the biggest component in terms of costs. You basically can also remove and reuse the inverters. So you take them off. You might even be able to reuse some of the mounting structure, the rackings, the rails, the clamps to the modules. But for example, the connections to the roof, you probably need new connectors, new feed for the roofs. You probably run new cables. All the low voltage components we normally suggest need to be new components. So I would say you can probably save about 50 to 60% of the solar system, and that is on the full system costs. I will come to that later on, because at the moment about a third of your investment actually comes down in terms of the rebate, these STCs, and I will come to that later. So if we say that you save 50% or 60% of your solar systems are reusable, it actually means that maybe 70 to 75% of your actual investment can be reused. So it's a pretty high percentage. Again, I do want to stress that really then depends on your new premises. It depends how easily it can be removed from your existing roof. But as a ballpark figure, somewhere about 50 to 70% is something you might want to take away from this discussion. Now let's go into more detail and compare some of these financing options. Now this is a direct investment. This is one of the very good cases. It's probably as good as it gets, really. This is an example for a 35 kilowatts system for an office with several employees. They have their computers and the air conditioning running during the day. Their solar value is 23 cents. So that means that they probably have their normal rate is maybe around 30 cents per kilowatt hours, but obviously Saturdays and Sundays they don't use any electricity, so that comes down to maybe 23 cents. Their savings in year one is $14,000 per annum, and the return on investment is a staggering 34%. The payback period is 3 years. So what you see on the right-hand side is a cumulative net savings. So obviously in year zero, let me turn that into a pointer, they have a negative because they need to invest in the solar system, but they then save every year. After 3 years, they have their money back, and then bang, they basically save on more than two decades onwards. And if we just have a straight line cumulative savings here, they save over $500,000 over the life of the solar system. And let me stress again, the system doesn't stop after 25 years. It continues to generate, but by then you might want to replace it with a new system, and we'll just have to then, it's just an economic decision whether you carry on with the old system, whether you sweat the asset, or whether you replace it with a new system. Now this is one of the good cases. Now let's look at that case, and let's say we had an operating lease over that system. So again, a 35 kilowatt solar system, the solar value stays the same, the annual savings stays the same, but they now have a lease arrangement over a 5 year period. The amazing thing in this particular case is they're actually cash flow positive from day one. What does that mean? It means that the saving they have from their solar system, these $14,000 per annum, is actually more than what they pay for their operating lease. So what you see here in the first 5 years, you see that it's actually positive. From day one, they are slightly positive. However, in the first 5 years, because they have to pay for their lease, they don't really benefit in full from the solar system. This doesn't happen until year six, and then from year six, bang, they have their full saving. And they basically then still have a saving over $500,000. Let me just go back one slide. It's a bit hard to tell on this slide. You can probably see that here, this cumulative saving is closer to maybe $570,000, whilst if we go forward, this saving is a little bit less, maybe 540, 530. It's basically the initial investment that you have, which you then, or the additional costs in terms of the third party finance that reduces your cumulative saving. But the remarkable thing here, really, which I want to stress again, that you save from day one, despite the fact that you haven't spent a penny, and you still get the full benefits from the solar system. Now, we've had a question come through. Let me just read that out. We are open 362 days per year, daytime only, North Coast, New South Wales. So how do I calculate the numbers of payback period, return on investment, etc.? Consider also I may not be able to use my roof, but I have plenty of land. So the way we would approach this is basically you get in contact with a solar developer like EFO or another company. They then usually, we would require the address where your business is, and we would look at your electricity bill. That's the first start. From once we've got hold of your electricity bill and we know what your business is and where you're located, we can make these initial assessments very quickly, and that is, in our case, that's free of charge, and we can then basically put you forward an initial draft solar business case. So the draft solar business case will give you a range on your benefits in terms of payback periods, return on investment, what we would believe is the required investment for your solar system and the overall benefits. At that stage, you look at it, you have a conversation with us or another developer, and you can then say, okay, it's worthwhile getting a full proposal, or you say, no, thank you, the payback period, you know, maybe it's 7 years, and you say, ah, it's too long, I don't want to do it. If you, however, say then, yes, you want to go ahead, you will get the full system design and we go into a contractual arrangement, and then the system gets installed, usually within maybe 3 weeks. It depends a little bit on the grid connection approval and maybe council approval, but a typical maybe 3 weeks, and then the system can be installed. I hope that sort of answered that question. Now, we have covered this for a very good case. Now, let's look at a case which is good, but not super good. So this is a solar system where under a direct investment, so the direct investment is just over $30,000, the company saves every year, and after 4 years, they have the initial investment back, and then they can benefit fully. I've only shown the 10 years here now to get a bit more transparency in these crucial years here. So this is the direct investment. What does this look like now if the company decides to go with an operating lease or a chattel mortgage? You see this here on the right-hand side. There's obviously no initial investment. So that's the key benefits and the key difference if you go through a third-party finance. However, in this case, what you pay for your lease is a little bit more than what you save. So you have a cash deficit in the first 5 years where you pay off your mortgage, your chattel mortgage, or your operating lease. So you see that the client is a little bit below zero over the first 5 years, but only slightly. So what we call the negative or the deficit cash position in this case is only around maybe $2,000. So they're hardly spending any money on their solar system, albeit in the first 5 years, they hardly benefit from the solar system either. But what happens after 5 years is basically they get their solar system almost for free, and then, bang, they get the full benefits of the solar system for the next 20 to 30 years. Now, I want to stress one thing. When you have that solar system on the roof, it obviously increases the value of that premises. It gives benefits to all future tenants or the all future occupants of the building because they can benefit from that solar system. So in most cases, if you are a tenant and you are long-term landed, like seven years or 10 years lease, you might want to talk to your landlord and come to some kind of arrangement that the landlord at the end of the lease maybe purchase the systems off you. I don't think that needs to be too sophisticated at this early stage. You can come to an arrangement to say, okay, after 10 years, you go into a discussion with the landlord, and then the landlord says, yes, they want to buy the system. If they don't want to buy the system, you take it off the roof and take it with you. And we discussed that earlier, that there's actually quite a lot of value still in the solar system, even when you remove it. So this kind of operating lease is a very, very good option, or the third-party finance is a very good option for a lot of businesses if they don't want to spend their own money on this. Now let's move on. And this is a pretty important part now to the discussion, and that's why, maybe that's the reason why so many people joined this webinar today. You might have picked up that the renewable energy target is under review. The renewable energy target at the moment provides about a third of the required investment. So if, let's make it simple, a 100 kilowatt solar system would cost $220,000, you actually get a rebate of around $70,000 on these $220,000. So your out-of-pocket expense, to keep the number simple, is $150,000. It's not really a rebate, it's these energy certificates, these small technology certificates that can be traded, and your solar developer like EFO would trade them for you, so you only pay the net amount of $150,000. This renewable energy target, the driver behind these energy certificates, is currently under review. There was a review panel that a couple of weeks ago made a recommendation, and it had two options. One is really to X this RET, to X get rid of the renewable energy target, or B, to reduce the threshold for these small technology certificates from 100 kilowatts to 10 kilowatts. Currently, if your system is larger than 100 kilowatts, you don't get this upfront discount or rebate. You get other benefits over the life of the solar system, but in terms of time value of money, it's quite a different value proposition. So at the moment, most commercial solar systems are up to 100 kilowatts to benefit from this one-time offset. Now, there are two significant differences in these two approaches. Option A means they would need to go through legislation. Government would need to go through legislation, and you know that in the Senate there are opposing opinions on this, and it would drag on quite a while, and there are probably another few months before any decision would be made if the government chose option A. However, option B could be changed immediately, because it's just it doesn't need to go through legislation. So this could happen tomorrow, basically, and all of a sudden you would not be able to get these benefits. Now, there is really a certain urgency if you want to consider solar as an option to reduce your power bills. So I explained earlier the power bills can be reduced by maybe 20% to 30%. So if that is something you want to consider, you should act rather sooner than later, because I explained that the direct investment required at the moment is reduced, would increase if this benefit is not there anymore, by 50%. So instead of paying $150,000 for a 100 kilowatt system, you would have to pay $220,000. Again, these numbers are just ballpark figures. Most cases the systems are actually cheaper, maybe 140, but it depends on many factors. I just wanted to keep the numbers simple. So your business could actually lose out on tens of thousands, or in this particular case on the 100 kilowatt system, on $70,000 if the government chooses to reduce the renewable energy target in the next couple of weeks. So it's really our call to action here if solar power is something you want to consider. Now, last polling question before I go to the summary. So if you don't mind, just to give us the answer on this question here, that's so after what you've heard, are you now interested to learn more about solar power to your benefit, to your business? So the answers are just sort of coming in. So about three quarters of you say yes, you would like to learn more. The other 25% roughly, I say they don't want to learn more, maybe they have heard it all before, or maybe it's just not for their business. I mean, that can certainly happen, that your business might just not be suitable for solar because or for various reasons. So thanks for the poll. So now let me come to my summary slide, and it's basically just to give you these figures again. On a bigger system, on a 100 kilowatt system, where we say the savings can be around the 20 per annum, can be around $25,000 to $30,000. This can obviously then amount to over $300,000 over 10 years, over $1 million over 25 years, the life of the system. You can lock in very low electricity rates with solar. It's equivalent to maybe 4 or 5 cents, and returns are typically about 20%, maybe 25%. If you are a smaller business and the system is smaller, maybe 20 kilowatts, obviously you pay much more for the electricity because your consumption is less. Your savings can be maybe $8,000 to $10,000 over 10 years, 88 over 20 years. So I'm not sure why that's 20 years now, but over $200,000, $300,000. The rate you lock in might be a little bit higher because a smaller system is a bit more expensive. It's maybe 6 cents per kilowatt hour, but return on investment can be 25% to 30%, and I showed you a case of 34% earlier in this presentation. So pretty attractive returns, and obviously with the third party finance, you don't need to spend any upfront capital. And once the system is paid off, it will generate sustainable and free electricity for decades to come. So where to from here is basically, where can you get help? Obviously, there are general industry organizations that can give you more information, and there's lots on their website. One of them is the Clean Energy Council, and others is basically also on our websites. There are many short videos on commercial solar if you want to have anything repeated of what I described to you in the webinar. And you can also make your life easier, go to our website and request a guide. That guide will go over a lot of the topics I've covered in this webinar again, and you can look at it at your own time, or just get on the website and send us an email and request more information and engage in a conversation with us. All right, so that's all for me. I hope that was helpful, and I thank you for the... Oh, there's one more comment, question come through. One sec. How does the reduction of the SDCs affect the LGCs? Well, that's a good question. They're currently under the renewable energy target. There are two schemes. One is the small renewable energy certificates, small renewable energy scheme, and the other one is the large scale. The large scale is for solar system and wind, solar from 100 kilowatts onwards, and then big wind generators. And the small scheme is for particular for solar under 100 kilowatts. They can be changed separately. Obviously, if the renewable energy target is X'd altogether, both schemes are gone. However, the SRES for the small scheme can be changed without any changes to the LGCs, and vice versa. For example, the LGC scheme can be changed without any effect on the SRES on the small scheme. So it does vary, and the government can pretty much do what they want as long as they can get it through the Senate. There's one more question coming through. Comparison between string system and integrated inverter modular system. So I assume that question goes into the direction whether string inverter or central inverters. So let me just quickly explain. On a string inverter system, maybe a 100 kilowatt inverter system, you might have 4 or 6 string inverters. You could alternatively have one big central inverter with 100 kilowatts. It's a bit of a philosophy of the designer, really. I mean, EFO, the company, the team within EFO comes from large scale. So we've all worked on big utility scale solar systems. So the engineering team and the head engineer in EFO has designed and delivered over 50, 60 megawatts of big solar farms. Obviously, these big solar farms are designed with massive central inverters, where one inverter block is maybe 1.25 megawatts, one single inverter block. With the commercial solar system, our philosophy at the moment, particularly with the 100 kilo up to 100 kilowatts, is still string inverters. Why that? Because string inverters are very easy to change and very easy to maintain. So if there is an issue with one of the 5 inverters, the benefit is that not the whole system goes down. It's really only one of the inverters that goes down, and it can be exchanged by a normal electrician. If you have central inverters, you need a special power electrician, and you tend to need special equipment and tools. And this is much more complicated and might drag on a bit. There are some benefits with central inverters, but generally speaking, for commercial solar systems, most of the systems we design are still with string inverters, but it really depends from case to case. And I think that was the last question. So thank you again for your attention, and I hand back to Carrie-Anne.
Thanks very much, Oliver. We've covered a lot of great information today that I'm sure our listeners will take away with them. Thanks everyone for participating. We'll be in touch later next week with a copy of the slides as well as a link to the webinar on demand. Thank you again, and thanks everyone for participating.